Thank you and welcome to all of our new supporters on Patreon. This is an independently produced show, written, researched, produced, edited, distributed, and promoted by us, Carolyn, Kristen, and Michelle, and paid for out of our own pockets because it's important to us. But you can help us pay the bills by clicking the Patreon link on our website, poppreservationists.com, or by going to our link in bio on Instagram and finding the Patreon link in our link tree. It's one of the best ways for you to tell us that you like what you hear, so we can keep on trucking. Thank you, and enjoy the show.
Well, and I think he's one of those artists, too, that can really bring a group together. I mean, no matter anybody who grew up in that time, no matter if you ended up really liking, you know, hard rock, or you were a Barry Manilow fan, or you were punk, whatever, you hear John Denver on the radio, or they play, you know, Country Boy at a wedding. Everyone is out there. I just feel like his music really brings people together.
Yeah.
Which
is
known by everybody.
Hello world is a song that we're singing. Come on, get happy. A whole lot of loving is what we'll be bringing. We'll make you happy.
Welcome to the Pop Culture Preservation Society, the podcast for people born in the big wheel generation who wore thongs to the pool. On our feet, people.
We believe our Gen X childhoods gave us unforgettable songs, stories, characters, and images. And if we don't talk about them, they'll disappear, like Marshall, Will, and Holly on a routine expedition.
And today, we will be saving the man who filled up our senses and put sunshine on our shoulders, His Rocky Mountain Highness, the far out John Deutschendorf. I mean, Denver. I'm Carolyn.
I'm Kristen.
And I'm Michelle. And we are your pop culture preservationists.
Well, life on the farm is kind of laid back. Ain't much an old country boy like me can hack. It's early to rise, early in the sack. Thank God I'm a country boy.
Few artists could pluck every melancholy string in our hearts like John Denver could. His talent for capturing just the right lyrics and pairing them with the perfect music set him apart in the 70s. Couple that with those round wireframe glasses, and you had an icon in the making. To me, John Denver was a brand. John Denver was a look. He was a sound. My gosh, even his name was a brand. He sang Rocky Mountain High, and his last name was Denver? Well, actually, his last name was Deutschendorf. He was born Henry Deutschendorf Jr. on December 31, 1943, in Roswell, New Mexico. His father was an Air Force pilot, and his career made the family move a great deal. And Michelle and I can certainly relate to this, because he moved his freshman year of high school to Dallas a little bit after the beginning of the school year started. Ouch, that just makes my skin just get all tingly. Exactly.
Parents, don't do that. Don't do that. Mm-mm. Although everybody listening probably doesn't have small children anymore.
But you might be able to relate to that feeling. But he found his place in chorus. So he joined the chorus class in chorus. And one day he was asked to bring in his guitar, because he had mentioned that he plays guitar. And as he tells the story, the rest is history. People went from not knowing who the heck he was to John Deutschendorf to knowing exactly who he was.
Well, can I also say that moving the beginning of your freshman year when you look like Cousin Oliver from the Brady Bunch has got to be even an added just like almost mark against you. So when he pulls out the guitar and that voice comes out, that's helpful.
Can you imagine? Mm-hmm. And it kind of made me think of what we learned about Karen Carpenter when she, to avoid gym class in high school, you know, took marching band. And because the only thing that they could put her in, because she didn't really play an instrument, was percussion, that's where she got her introduction to the drums and decided, hey, I really like the drums. So if it wasn't for that experience in high school and joining band, who knows?
God, arts education,
would have discovered that talent of hers.
Right.
That's why it's
so true.
Arts education.
Mm-hmm. We wouldn't have these heroes if it weren't for arts education.
Right.
John's love of music and his talent found him actually leaving college early and eventually joining a folk group called the Mitchell Trio. Now, this trio performed around the country, primarily at small venues and colleges. And it was at one of these college concerts that John Denver met his first wife, Annie Martell in 1966. Yes, that iconic Annie of Annie's Song. And guess what, listeners? That meeting happened right down the road from us at Gustavus Adolphus College in St. Peter, Minnesota, Annie's hometown. Can you believe?
I just got goosebumps for some reason because I didn't know that.
Isn't that crazy?
Yeah.
And how many kids there know that history? Like, do they know they're at the alma mater of Annie? Like, we don't have to say anything besides Annie.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so my niece is in the choir at Gustavus right now. I'm going to call her and say, you guys should end every concert with Annie's Song.
Every concert, right.
Right.
Every concert.
Annie and John married in 1967, and after living in Chicago for a brief time, they moved. You guys, they moved to Edina, Minnesota.
It's
Kristen
just
probably
good.
Already knows that, but Edina, Minnesota.
Know that. Is this the what you didn't
want me to know? Oh my gosh, you didn't know that?
I didn't know either. Is this what you didn't want me to know?
You didn't?
No.
Yes, it is Carolyn, what I didn't want you to know.
Live in Edina.
I live in Edina, and not only that, Kristen, every time I drive to your house, I drive by where he lived. I drive
to
John Denver's apartment.
I was going to ask you. I was like, somebody lives in John Denver's house, and do they even know? Do they even know?
It's an apartment, and research found, not my research, I glommed onto someone else's, if you looked in the Hennepin County actual phone book in 1968, you would have found Henry John Deutschendorf Jr. listed, and they actually lived in an apartment.
Okay, you want to know another little factoid? You guys, my friend Martha, her dad says he remembers seeing a guy named John Deutschendorf performing at the Edina Country Club back in the late 60s.
Stop it.
I know.
I believe it.
I know.
Because guess what? In 1969, he actually performed at Edina High School when there was a protest concert and more than 1,000 students walked out of class into the gym to protest teacher cuts. They thought teachers needed to be saved, arts education needed to be saved, and lo and behold, John Denver played. And guess what? Few of the students even knew who he was.
Oh, not yet. Yeah.
Yeah, no. I mean,
he's not a person yet.
Mm-hmm. Right. And he, there's actually pictures of him in the yearbook and stuff performing at Edina High School.
Wow.
I know. I was dumbfounded, you guys. I had no idea
his connection to here. That's such great information for me.
Yes, he even in interviews, I read a couple of articles where he was interviewed. He considers Minnesota Minneapolis and Edina one of his hometowns. Like, this is where a lot of
stuff. Oh my God, I just got goosebumps.
Did they stay here just because that's where Annie was from?
Yeah.
Is that why they stayed here?
I think that was obviously a big draw. Chicago was just too much. And they, I guess, still wanted to be or needed to be kind of near a big city because he was traveling. He was part of the trio and starting his own solo career. So he needed to probably be near an airport and that kind of thing. I'm guessing on all this. But her parents were really close. So, so they were here from 1968 to about 1970. It wasn't long before John's career started to take off. John Denver recorded and released approximately 300 songs in his career.
Wow.
About 200 of those he composed. He had 33 albums and singles that were certified gold and platinum in the U.S. Four of those singles reached number one on the Billboard charts. Can you guess what those were as a singer?
The number one songs. He only had four. One of them was Annie's Song.
Yes.
Yeah.
One of them was Sunshine on My Shoulders.
Yes.
One of them was Thank God I'm a Country Boy.
Yes.
And the last one is Rocky Mountain High.
Has to be.
Sunshine on My Shoulders, Country Boy, Annie Song, and I'm Sorry.
That was a number one song?
Yes. And then I have Take Me Home, Country Roads, peaked at number two.
I think that's right. Yeah.
But where does that leave us with Rocky Mountain High? So that wasn't even on there. So that, as I'm saying it out loud, that sounds weird, everybody.
Are you looking right now?
I am.
I'm looking at
it. It does say, I'm Sorry reached number one on the Billboard Hot 100 chart on September 27th, 1975, as well as reaching number one on the Easy Listening chart. Yeah.
So how
high did Rocky... flip side of I'm Sorry was? A great song, Calypso.
What?
Oh, I
Calypso, I
love that one.
The
I don't know the words, but but this is how I connect like to sing that song.
Yeah. So long and so well. Allie.
Now that we're talking about his music, let's chat a little bit about that. About what it meant to us, what our favorite songs might have been, favorite memories. Because guess what? This past summer was actually the 50th anniversary of Rocky Mountain High. Can you believe that?
You guys, we seem to be coming into contact with so many 50th anniversaries lately.
It's because we're old.
Yeah.
It's we're just hitting everything that started. It's like our prime began in 1972.
I know.
Everything that is important to us started in 1972.
I mean, that was just a great, well, the 70s, such great iconic decade as we have a whole podcast chatting about a lot of that.
These are not records that I had in my house. This is in the category of a lot of records where I discovered them at somebody else's house. And this was at Aunt Chase's house. Her parents had all the John Denver records. And they also knew a lot of information about them. And so when we're looking at the cover of Back Home Again that has John Denver sitting on a log with his wife Annie, Aunt Chase is telling me, this is his wife Annie, and this is what the song is about. And they have two children. Their names are Zachary and Anna Kate. And we want to talk about this family as if we know them personally. And then Aunt Chase was the one who introduced me to all the songs, like Grandma's Featherbed. I mean, that is a kid's song if I ever heard one, right? Thank God I'm a country boy. I did a tap dance to Thank God I'm a Country Boy in seventh grade. You should have seen me in my turquoise overalls and my tap shoes.
I know. Your parents don't have that on any kind of...
You guys, I started dancing in the era prior to the VCR.
Yeah.
And that is a huge loss. I mean, my dad could have taken Super 8 movies, I suppose, but first of all, you wouldn't have the music. And secondly, I would have killed him. I would have been like, I'm going to sit down on this stage and I'm not moving until you put that camera away.
I would have loved to have seen it, though.
I know. Oh, well.
Yeah.
Any other feel?
Class, does anyone else in the class have some feelings?
I mean, my feelings, I think for me, I don't remember specifically listening to John Denver when I was younger, but I obviously did a lot. I'm going to doubt we had John Denver albums at my house because that John Denver just does not seem like my mom's genre of music that she listened to. So I'm going to guess I listened to a lot of John Denver when I was visiting my daddy. And then just on the radio all the time, because certainly these are not songs that I became aware of when I was in, you know, middle school, high school, whatever. These are songs that are just part of the fabric of our childhood. So yes, on the radio. But to me, John Denver, we've talked about this many times, but his music, almost all of his music, and it's just his voice, to me, my feelings are just that lumpy, almost twisty feeling in a really good way. I have a lot of feelings associated with John Denver songs. I just don't know where they came from.
Well, and I think he's one of those artists, too, that can really bring a group together. I mean, no matter anybody who grew up in that time, no matter if you ended up really liking, you know, hard rock, or you were a Barry Manilow fan, or you were punk, whatever, you hear John Denver on the radio, or they play, you know, Country Boy at a wedding. Everyone is out there. I just feel like his music really brings people together.
Yeah.
Which
is it's known by everybody.
Yeah.
Correct. Mm-hmm. Yes. Well, any favorite songs now that we're talking about this music? Michelle,
it's impossible. One of your favorites? It's almost impossible to pick. So this is hard. So I pulled a Kristen and I have a couple of ties. So my first category is in fun songs. And these are two songs that I remember singing in fifth grade music class. And these two songs, we would all clap. We would sing our hearts out. And I remember these two songs also were like the only songs the boys would get so into. It's Thank God I'm a Country Boy and Grandma's Featherbed. And Grandma's feather bed was one that was just, well, both of them were just a rollicking good time in the fifth grade music class. Do you guys remember when, so we didn't have, like, we'd leave our classroom, we'd all have to walk in our rows, you know, down to music class. In fifth grade, it wasn't like choir where you had to audition and it was an elective. Everybody has to go to music class. So sometimes a lot of kids in your class don't like music class, but everybody liked to sing "Thank God I'm a Country Boy" and "Grandma's Feather Bed." How can you not love a song that has lyrics like this? I'm going to sing it now, but please don't put this in. It was 9 feet high and six feet wide.
Soft as a downy chick. It made from the feathers of 4 11 geese. Took a whole bowl of broth for the chick. In all 8 kids, 4 hound dogs. The figure we stole from the shed. Didn't get much sleep, but we had a lot of fun on Grandma's.
God, I mean, love it so
when
much.
When you have lyrics like 4011 geese. And then
4011 geese.
Besides 4011 geese, my favorite lyric from that song is, and a piggy we stole from the shed. I love it.
Anytime you put in piggy.
I know.
People are going to love
piggy
it.
Piggy we stole.
You got to use the word piggy.
So
it's
great.
A good word.
And before I go to my next song, I just want to tell you a really fun story, you guys, from one of our great supporters and one of our Patreon patrons. And this is from Amy. And when she found out we were doing an episode on John Denver, she shared this story with us. She said, so she was a little sister to siblings who were 8, 11, and 14 years older than she was. So she said they listened to a lot of John Denver growing up. And when she was in college, she and her sorority sisters went to see an acoustic duo who sang Grandma's Feather Bed. Now, can we just stop right there, though, for a moment and imagining the acoustic duo and they chose to sing of all the John Denver songs in his catalog that would go perfectly for an acoustic duo? They sang Grandma's Feather Bed, whatever. But Amy says her sorority sisters were fascinated that she knew all the words. And so they had her write them all down so that they could memorize them too. Isn't that cute?
And then, 'cause they liked it.
Yeah. And it is a song with a lot of words, right?
Yes.
And then Amy says, like 25 years later, she taught Montessori and it was a song she used to sing to all her little Montessori kids, which is so
cute.
Yeah. Yeah. Amy, we love that story. Thank you for sharing that with us. Okay. And then my other category where I have ties is just the songs that make me feel all the feels. And of course, one of those is Annie's song. I think everybody probably feels that way. And I think we all know, obviously it was written for his wife, Annie, after they had had after their first separation and near complete breakup of their marriage in 1974. But John Denver said he wrote, it was one of the fastest songs he ever wrote. He composed it in 10 minutes on a chairlift in Aspen because he said he was just reflecting on all the joy he found in his marriage and his relief that they were back together. And I think to me, that song, the melody is so beautiful, but it's the lyrics, especially these, that just make this song for me. Come, let me love you.
Let me give my life to you. Let me drown in your laughter. Let me die in your arms.
That's poetry.
He's saying
that is the most beautiful
what
love
everybody
letter.
Longs mm-hmm. to hear.
Oh,
that
yeah.
he wins everybody over because everybody wants someone to sing that to them.
It is a love letter. It's the most beautiful love letter, and I think we know that sadly wasn't enough. But yeah, it's beautiful.
And Annie's song is obviously a big wedding song. So my dad sang this a lot at weddings.
You fill up my senses. Like a night in the forest, like the mountains in springtime, like a walk in the rain, like a storm in the desert.
And like I don't even, this isn't the category of songs for me, the ultimate sad song in which I don't even have to hear the song to start crying. I just have to think about the song and I start crying. I get all choked up. And it made me so invested in this person, Annie. Who is Annie? And she's on the cover of the album, like I said, not like Linda McCartney, where she's on the cover of the album and then he puts her in the band. No, he just puts her on the cover because of this beautiful song that everybody is so invested in. He never says her name in the song. So I think I called this song You Fill Up My Senses for most of the time. But then when I learned the title, I just needed to know all about Annie. And as a result, we all fell in love with them as a couple. Hashtag couple goals. She was his mountain mama, right? Yeah. We were so invested in them that when he remarries and he releases a new album in the 90s and there's this video of him canoodling with his new wife, we're all like, no.
Nope.
No. No. We don't like you.
Who's that bitch?
Right.
No.
We don't like her.
How? I mean, that's horrible. That poor woman. I'm sorry, John Denver's second wife. I'm very sorry, but I was like, no. I just refused to go there.
Yeah, it's like we cross our arms and turn our heads sideways. Nope.
Yes.
Right.
You Fill Up My Senses is exactly, Kristen, you just nailed that. That's what I always knew that song as. I think I was probably a young adult when, you know, this is to my husband and myself. I mean, John Denver is our bonfire music. That is our, that's something that we bonded over right away too when we were dating. We love to sing John Denver. And it sounds like we're like we're an acoustic duo. We are not. But I remember when I would look at playlists on our CDs and I'd be like, Annie's song? What's Annie's song? What's and when Annie's song would come out, because I, unlike you, I didn't go back to like, I don't remember the album cover or know that story until I was a young adult. And I then remember loving the fact that her name was never in the song, but the song was just simply, he could have called it anything. I loved, always loved and thought it was so much more beautiful and romantic that he called it Annie's song.
Well, and then that makes it able to be a wedding song because it doesn't say, you fill up my senses, Annie, with it, right? Like you don't have to worry about who they're singing to. It's a song for anybody to sing in any wedding.
Right. Yeah. It is a beautiful, God, that is a beautiful wedding song, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. Everyone starts boohooing immediately.
Did your dad sing it at weddings?
All the time.
Oh.
All the time. Oh, yeah.
Would he sing it for us now? Could we get a little like...
yeah, he probably will.
Karaoke and like have that as a little...
I should ask him.
Yeah.
I'll have him do the little voicemail thing and sing You Fill Up My Senses. My dad is like, he's like a... how do I describe it? If you heard his vocal music performance for his vocal music degree, what you would hear is... It's not English, right? So that's how he sings. So when he sings You Fill Up My Senses, he doesn't sound like John Denver. He sounds like a man singing opera, but you fill up my senses.
It's like Luciano Pavarotti singing.
Yes, that is exactly right.
Josh Groban's version. Josh Groban.
I think Pavarotti has sung Annie's song. Look it up. I'm pretty sure Pavarotti has sung Annie's song.
I don't like when he sings any songs, like when does a cover. Like, I'm sorry, Pavarotti. Opera singers should not do covers.
I kind of think
we love
Groban
you for who
too.
You are.
Yeah.
Agree.
Okay, another song that's one of my favorites that I don't know that it's a lot of people's one that they think of immediately when they think of John Denver songs, but I chose it because this is another one that I remember singing in choir. Now, I've moved to middle school choir now, so now I've had to, you know, now this is for the real kids who want to sing, and you know,
you get a part. You chose to be there.
You get a part. But we sang this song in one of our choir concerts, and ever since then, it has just been one of my favorite songs, and that is Follow Me. And this is another song that John Denver says he wrote for Annie. Also, he said this on The Tonight Show in 1974. He said he wrote it for his wife, Annie, whom he had to leave behind when he was touring early on in his career because he couldn't afford to take her with him.
Oh, gosh. Hmm.
I think that's where a lot of busyness happened with John Denver, too, when he couldn't afford, I'm using air quotes. Aww. I'm sorry, can't afford to take you with me. But anyway, the lyrics at the beginning are so beautiful, but yet they're heartbreaking. It says, it's by far the hardest thing I've ever done to be so in love with you.
So alone. Follow me where I go, what I do, who I know. Make it part of you to be a part of me.
And again with the poetry, John Denver.
How is he able to say those things? Mike if I could offer Mike $1 million and he wouldn't be able to say that.
Yeah. That's one of those songs. So can't you just hear our sixth grader standing in choir and you've got the altos, you know, follow me, what I do.
where you know? I go.
Yeah, that was my part. Follow me.
Let me tell you a really interesting fact about that song. And getting back to John's love of Minnesota, he flew in especially for the wedding of Minnesota TV personalities Nancy Nelson and Bill Carlson. And he sang this song for
Good Follow Company.
Me. Yes, at his
oh
at the
God.
Wedding.
No way. I grew yes, up on when, Good Company every day at 3:30.
There you go.
Wow. Awesome.
He flew in especially for their wedding and was a soloist performing that song. Okay. Kristen, let me know what some of your favorite songs are.
So my favorite, much like Michelle, was cemented in music class with Mrs. Burson with her auto harp. You know, she's got her auto harp in her lap.
I love the auto harp. Can I just say I loved the auto harp?
It is a good, yeah. And also, can I just give a shout out? You just gave a shout out. You know how I remember nothing from my childhood? I can remember, so my fifth grade music class was also my middle school choir teacher. And that's Mrs. Casperson. And we remember Mrs. Casperson because Mrs. Casperson was kind of like the tight perm, giant glasses, kind of short, you know, a little frumpy 1979, 80s woman. But Mrs. Casperson drove a pacer. So Mrs. Casperson was elevated in all of our minds because she drove a pacer. It was the coolest thing ever. Okay. Anyway.
She got cool points.
Hey, Miss Casperson. I think she's dead. Go ahead.
So Mrs. Burson was one of my music teachers. My other music teacher was my dad. I know. Mrs. Burson with her auto harp, you know, and she put the lyrics on the overhead projector so we could all sing. Who among us has not belted out Country Roads as we road tripped through the Blue Ridge Mountains, or as you cross the state line into West Virginia, or simply when you turn onto a country road?
These country roads take me home to the place I belong, West Virginia.
Become an anthem. It's impossible. Even if you just see a mountain, you just see it and somebody starts going, almost heaven.
Oh,
if you just see a mountain, right? It's so known by the culture that even our Gen Z children know this song. There was a time a few years ago, I wonder if this bled over to your guys' areas as well, when this song took off among school kids. It was kind of like when Toto's Africa had this resurgence for a while. I don't know if it was TikTok or but suddenly every other kid at the piano recital or at the school talent show was playing Country Roads on the ukulele. And they did it with glee, like they had discovered this hidden gem of some kind. And of course, all of us in the audience are like crying and we all know we're clapping and we all know the songs. Like, how do our parents know the words to this song? And of course, it is the official song of the state of West Virginia. But I was super disappointed to learn that the Welcome to West Virginia sign does not say almost heaven. I swear to God, I've seen this. Welcome to West Virginia.
Should.
Almost
yeah,
heaven.
It should.
It well, doesn't.
No offense to our West Virginia listeners, but have either of you ever been to West Virginia?
Yes, I have.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's not almost. So they were like, that would be a lie.
That would be not truth in advertising.
I have a question. Did he write that song because he ever lived in what? Did he have a tie to West Virginia at all?
Funny you should ask, Michelle.
Oh. It's almost like that was scripted, which it wasn't.
That's right. John Denver had never even been to West Virginia, nor had the people who wrote the song. The people who wrote it were named Bill and Taffy Danoff, and they were friends of John Denver's, and they would eventually go on to form their own band called the Starland Vocal Band. Sky rockets in flight. Afternoon delight.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Those are the people who wrote this song. Neither one of them had ever been to West Virginia. They wrote the song as they were driving through the state of Maryland. And for whatever reason, the scenery reminded them of postcards that they would get from a friend of theirs who did live in West Virginia. So somehow they made it, I guess it was like almost heaven, Maryland.
We have a patron, a 1976 patron, I believe, that lives in West Virginia, because I believe I mail little packages when I send those out
to our bicentennial
members. Well, I do address one to West Virginia.
I would imagine that as you're driving through the Blue Ridge Mountains Shenandoah River, it is almost heaven.
It is.
Right? No matter what the state line is. Yeah.
Yes.
So the Danoffs, in other words, the Starland Vocal Band, the Starland Vocal Band people really wanted Johnny Cash to sing the song because they didn't think this really was John Denver's type. Like, this is not John's style.
Oh, my gosh.
Really?
And it goes on to be his signature song.
Yes.
It's his signature song, and it goes on to live forever.
Yes.
It's an anthem. So it was released in the spring of 1971, but it moved up the charts very slowly because he's still a little-known singer. People don't really know who John Denver is, but it eventually reached number two later in that year, and it stayed on the chart for 23 weeks. For 6 months, it was on the chart.
Yeah, I was about to say, if I'm doing the math correctly, that's half a year.
That is half a year.
Look at me doing math in season seven, guys.
Good for you.
Thanks.
Took seven seasons. So as you know, and as everybody listening knows, after hearing the first verse, almost heaven, people are compelled to join in on the chorus. It's involuntary. It's like a Sweet Caroline moment, right? Mm-hmm. And this is from songfacts.com. I love this so much. They say people feel compelled to join in on the chorus, especially in a group environment or if alcohol is involved.
Hashtag bonfire.
That's right. So this came into play with the St. Louis Blues hockey team. They learned this in 2019 when they played the song during a break in the game. And when the play resumed, they faded the song out just as the chorus was about to begin. No song. And the crowd, in perfect synchronicity, sings the chorus. And a tradition is born. So this is the song that is now played at every single game. And when they get to the chorus, they turn the track off and the audience sings it a cappella just as the play resumes on the ice, which is very surreal because this does not seem like the soundtrack to a face-off, really, right? Country Roads. And then on the Jumbotron, it's so funny because you see these grown men with hockey hair and they're arm in arm and they're belting out John Denver. Just at the top of their lungs.
I love it. See, like we said before, his music brings people together.
Mm-hmm. It does.
In these communal moments. Mm-hmm. I have the chills. That's so fun.
It allows people to let their guard down and be happy for a moment about something simple and fun.
Right. That we all share and know.
Yeah.
I mean, this is the shared experience. Just beautiful.
And think about that as part of his legacy, right? This man has been gone for a really long time.
Right.
And sometimes his reputation took a few knocks. And now here he is being played at every game of a national hockey team. And how many of those thousands of people are in the audience? Thousands and thousands of people are in the audience. Just pure joy every single time
ages.
They go to a game.
Of all ages.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Sorry, I just get emotional about these things.
I know. It's okay.
I love it.
I know.
Do you have your season seven Kleenex box?
Right.
It needs to come down from the ceiling.
I remember, it's so funny, I remember road tripping I was caravanning from Minneapolis. I was moving to North Carolina with a friend. The friend whose father saw John Deutschendorf at the Edina Country Club.
Oh.
We're caravanning to North Carolina, and I'm right behind her little Honda. I'm in my little Mazda pickup. And I see a sign that says Blue Ridge Mountains. We're not anywhere near West Virginia, but I see the Blue Ridge Mountains and I start going, almost heaven. And I sing the whole thing and we get out of the car and Martha was like, I did it too. Like, we were both caravanning, singing the same song when we saw the sign. Mm-hmm. And then as you're singing the song, and I think this is John Denver's intention, as I'm singing the song, I'm looking around at the Blue Ridge Mountains. I'm like, holy shit, this is amazing. I may not have even noticed. If I hadn't seen that sign and started singing this song, I might not have stopped to notice how stunningly beautiful this is.
Well, I would argue that anytime people are in Colorado and see a sign for the Rocky Mountains, they do the same thing with Rocky Mountain High. Mm-hmm.
And the lyrics, too, I will say, when you talk about poetry, just that whole notion, he was born in the summer of his 27th year, what that means, right? It wasn't until he stepped foot in the Rocky Mountains that he said, Now I've come to be. Now I'm here. Mm-hmm. Coming home to a place he'd never been before.
Right.
God, it's so great. Okay, I also want to talk a little bit about, because I'm leaving on a jet plane. And you talked about this a little bit, Carolyn. You brought this up when we did our new intro to our Sad Songs episode just a few weeks ago, the I'm Not Crying, You're Crying, as a song that really chokes you up and makes you cry. And I never thought that I thought that. I sort of had neutral feelings about leaving on a jet plane. But then I listened to it again after you brought it up. And I'm singing along, because who doesn't know the words to this song? And I find myself choking up when he gets to the part that says, "So kiss me and smile for me. Tell me that you'll wait for me. Hold me like you'll never let me go."
That's my favorite part. Again,
oh, God, it just hurts, right? And again, he's saying the things that we all long to hear. And this is the interesting story about this song. It has long been categorized as a protest song, but it is not. It was written by John Denver and became a huge hit for Peter, Paul, and Mary, and is often thought as an anti-war song against the Vietnam War. But actually, John Denver wrote it in an airport in 1966 as a confessional, begging for forgiveness as an unfaithful traveling musician. And he says, "There's so many times I've let you down, so many times I've played around. I tell you now, they don't mean a thing." Oh, wow. John Denver. They did, actually.
Michelle is giving him no leeway on some of that.
But the song was released in 1967 by Peter, Paul, and Mary, not by John Denver. And it didn't do much for 2 years until 1969, when the war in Vietnam is reaching its peak. And what the public heard was a man on the verge of being deployed and desperately trying to get things straight with his lady. And he doesn't want to leave. He's clinging to this life that he doesn't want to leave. And he's scared. And he's promising, "When I come home, I'll wear your wedding ring," or "bring your wedding ring," depending on who's singing it, John Denver or Mary Travers. And the listener is now going, "Oh, please, God, please, please let him come home." It's excruciating. So it became Peter, Paul, and Mary's biggest hit. It went to number one in 1969. John Denver's version never charted. And that's the one that I think of.
Hmm. Yeah. Yeah. Me too. When I first heard it as a little kid, I knew all the words, sang along. And it wasn't until I think I had these experience of saying goodbye and leaving people that I really loved, which only happened as I got older. And now when I hear that song, it's like he was able to put that just that awful piercing feeling of saying goodbye to someone that you love into words and to the music. I mean, the music makes you feel that too. And I am just there again, and it's sad.
"So kiss me and smile for me. Tell me that you'll wait for me. Hold me like you'll never let me go. 'Cause I'm leaving on a jet plane. Don't know when I'll be back again."
My favorite song, or the one that I guess means the most to me, especially that now that I've done a little research, is "Sunshine on My Shoulders." So that song was originally released as an album track in 1971 on his album Poems, Prayers, and Promises. I just love the title of that darn thing.
Isn't that beautiful?
Yes, I know. I love that title. It wasn't released as a single until 1973. It went to number one on the Billboard Hot 100 chart in early 1974. And as I said, having done a little research, I love this song even more because I discovered that John wrote it experiencing one of those late winter gray mushy days that we get here in Minneapolis. Mm-hmm. And just imagining what it feels like when that sun actually hits your shoulders and you get that warmth after the winter.
"Sunshine on my shoulders makes me happy. Sunshine in my eyes can make me cry."
And I
can so relate now, having lived in Minnesota for as long as I can. I know that feeling, and he captures it. And when he talks about, you know, the sunshine on the water, I think he was walking around Lake Harriet. He was.
I have wondered that, Carolyn. Well, because do you recall the story about?
Yes.
And this was, again, was also in our sad songs episode. I talked about Liam and I walking to the lake that is near my house, and he's in his stroller. He's like a 2-year-old, and I think we're having a conversation about how beautiful the water is, the sunshine on the water is, and how the sparkling water makes him cry. And he's actually quoting Sunshine on My Shoulders. I was like, wait, what?
He's like a John Denver savant.
At 2 years old. Yeah, he's like a John Denver savant. And now, just like you, Carolyn, I'm like, oh my God, what if, because this would be the lake closest to his house.
Right.
What
right.
if that's actually written about my lake?
I think it is.
Oh my God, I can't even stand it.
That's what I'm going to go believe. And so it puts a whole nother spin on this song for me to love.
Yeah.
Because really, before even learning all this, even though the song isn't necessarily sad, it would make me feel kind of sad, like really melancholy.
It's the melody of it, I think.
Yes, it is. And I also think because of what I probably associated it with. So, another reason that it gives me this heart-achy feeling is that it was the theme song to the 1973 CBS TV movie Sunshine.
That's right.
Do you guys remember that movie?
Describe it.
The movie, it was based on a true story, so a docudrama, about a young mother who is dying of cancer and wants to record this last year of her life. It's a very aggressive form of cancer.
I know.
Is super sad. And that's the theme song to it. Actually, the soundtrack contains 7 John Denver songs because he found out the woman that the movie is based on, his music brought her some comfort during this last year of her life. So when they asked if they could use his music, he was honored to have that included in the movie. Now, just a little bit of fun facts about this movie. Lindsay and Sydney Greenbush, who would go on to be Carrie in Little House on the Prairie. This was TV debut.
Right.
Yes. This was their television debut, was playing the toddler of this character that was dying. And get this, you guys. The actress that played the character's mother, Brenda Vaccaro.
Brenda Vaccaro. With my cigarettes and my tampons.
But in this case, it's her daughter dying. So, so that is why up until I learned this other stuff, it was always so sad to me because I always associated it with this movie, which I also thought that the Sunshine Family Dolls was based on the characters from this movie, but I don't think
I ever did too. That's why I didn't like those dolls. I did not like them.
What? You thought the dolls were based on the movie about the woman dying of cancer?
And I was afraid of them. What? I was afraid. Yes. It was too scary.
I love the Sunshine Family Dolls. They look like Mary and her husband on Little House on the Prairie.
They do, but they were always sad to me. Yeah, I thought, who would want these dolls that where the mom dies? I couldn't figure it out. That's where
who wants to play that their mom dies?
So did you guys also then think like sunshine? Like anytime you heard sunshine was associated with the movie, like go outside and play in the sunshine. And you guys are like,
no, but if you said it was on my shoulders, if you said, oh, I feel sunshine on my shoulders, I would have thought of it. And that is a heartbreaking movie. I mean, it's right up there with Brian's song.
Oh, I won't watch movies like that.
Yeah. While there's no doubt that John's music made a lasting impact on us, he wasn't just a one-trick pony. Not only did his voice come out of our speakers, but we could also see his image on the screen.
Yeah, he was he was everywhere in the 70s and all through the 80s. And I don't know about you guys, but when I think about John Denver in terms of an actor, I immediately think of Oh God.
Me too.
And Oh God, listeners, if you haven't listened to our episode devoted to the movie with George Burns and John Denver, Oh God, that was a really fun and surprising episode for us. We kind of went into it thinking, where are we doing this kind of obscure movie that we all loved, although Carolyn watched it for the first time.
Right.
And it turned into such a fun conversation. Yeah, it was a deeper conversation, which we tend to do a lot. So yeah, go to wherever you're listening to this podcast or our website and scroll back till you find Oh God. But anyway, I think we mentioned this in the episode, but it's worth repeating because at the time, Oh God was the highest grossing comedy ever And John Denver's performance was critically acclaimed by both critics and audiences. And that movie, it just really stands up. We talk about that in our
episode. It does. You can watch it today and it holds up.
Yeah, we highly recommend it. But besides Oh God, the next thing I think of when I think of John Denver, the actor, is the Muppets. Do you guys think of the Muppets?
Totally.
Yes. And so after his first appearance on the Muppet Show in 1979, John Denver and Jim Henson apparently developed a lifelong friendship, which sadly wasn't very long because Jim Henson died in 1990. And that led to other collaborations like The Muppets, A Christmas Together in 1979 and Rocky Mountain Holiday in 1983. Have you guys seen that one?
I don't know. John Denver takes the
Muppets camping in the Rockies. It is so dang cute to see all the Muppets. They're just hiking along with John Denver. And, they're kind of bouncing because you can't see their legs, obviously.
Right.
So their little bodies, John Denver's walking.
Like this.
He's hiking.
This is walking.
Yeah, he's walking. And when they pull up, they're all in a big pickup truck. So some of the Muppets are in the cab with John Denver. John Denver's driving, obviously. And then some of them are all on the back. But it's really cute. I rewatched it last week. And, of course, Fozzie is afraid of bears throughout the whole thing, which is the running gag, that album.
My dog looks like Fozzie Bear.
Yeah. And of course they have to sing Grandma's Feather Bed in that one. In the special, listeners, I'm sure there's listeners out there that remember this special and that are saying, I remember that, but they come across like this old shack in the Rockies. And of course there's these old Muppet, miners or whatever that live there with like all the beards and the eyebrows that are so big that all you see on their Muppet face is a big nose, and they're like playing banjos and everything. It's really cute. I have a fun fact about that. So the album Rocky Mountain Holiday, they released in 1982, the special didn't come out till 1983, but in 1984, that album was nominated for a Grammy Award for Best Album for Children, but it lost to, are you ready for this?
Oh,
to Michael Jackson's E.T., The Extraterrestrial Storybook.
Oh, no.
Yeah,
that doesn't
seem right. I don't know about
right.
that one. Yeah, but how could John Denver and the Muppets lose to Michael Jackson singing about E.T.?
Well, and I recall, I'm going to be honest here, I never listened to the Michael Jackson E.T. thing, and
no,
I was
true.
A big Michael Jackson fan, but I remember seeing that and thinking, I don't want that. I don't want that.
Especially, the Muppets were huge back then. So, they still are. So besides, Oh God, besides the Muppets, John Denver is also often remembered for his many, many, many television specials. And hosted the Grammys five times. You guys remember the one, I forgot the year, but it's Sean Cassidy's first appearance, and he's got the giant
77.
Bow tie.
Oh, yeah, 77. Big, yes, 1977.
Yes. I love that one. That's such a fun one to go back and watch. So I am doing my research for this because, it's so tough. Isn't it tough, you guys, doing homework and research for our episodes?
Oh, yeah, we're working so hard.
Mm-hmm. I know. So I had to go back and
someone's
got to
do it.
I guess. You're welcome, listeners. A couple of the specials I watched over this past weekend were John Denver and the Ladies. Thank you, Carolyn, for bringing that one to our attention. John Denver and the Ladies. That is a 1979 television special. And it's John Denver and White Tails. And here's his ladies. We've got Valerie Harper. Great. We've got Cheryl Teagues. I mean, these are hot ladies of 1979, right? We've got Valerie Harper, Cheryl Teagues, Tina Turner, Cheryl Ladd, and... Irma Bombeck.
What?
Can I just say?
Irma Bombeck was on TV? Why? Yeah,
well, 1979, Irma Bombeck is a hot commodity. This is when she is all over the news, everything, right? She's such a popular author. And don't forget, before that, there really hadn't been someone writing, humor pieces about just being a housewife. And raising your kids and doing the laundry, cooking dinner before Irma Bombeck. So
My mom loved her. Remember
I still love her.
If life is a bowl of cherries, why am I always in the pits?
But I also watched his 1988 Aspen Christmas special, so that's 9 years later. And this is John Denver just being who he is. He had many Christmas specials, but I chose to watch this one. And it had everything I want in a Christmas special. I mean, Aspen at Christmas should be contained in a snow globe, right? It's gorgeous. Yep. He sings, besides Christmas hits, he sings a couple of his greatest hits, which when you have you know, a singer who has a Christmas special, you always want them to sing. You know, he sings Country Roads in it. He sings Rocky Mountain High in it. And then his guest, you guys, his guest is Anne Murray. And I love Anne Murray. And I especially love Christmas song Anne Murray. And she sings a couple of Christmas songs, you know, of course, while strolling through the snow and like, you know, watching the horses run by and watching the children have snowball fights. And then he introduces us to his new wife, Cassandra. And he sings a song he wrote for her, complete with the montage of them in the snow. Do you guys remember the Donnie and Debbie montage from the Osmond's Family Christmas, where they're like throwing snowballs at each other and they're walking, holding hands and looking? It's the song he sings for her that he says he just wrote for her. And he says how they met and how they got married while he's sitting with his arm around her. And so there's that personal touch to the special, even if it is his new wife. And it's not Annie, who we will always be true to and love.
And then sorry, you can't introduce us to your true love and then introduce us to your other true love. I'm sorry, second wife.
But that's what I felt like when I watched it. I felt like, because then he makes a big deal of that he had to write this song for her. And that felt gross to me because we know Annie's song. There's nothing that will ever compare to that. And mm-hmm. so when he says he had to write the song, and I almost felt most sorry for her. And if you watch the special, and I encourage everybody to do it. Actually, you guys, it's one of those that, like, you know, when you just kind of want to watch an old Christmas special during the holidays, it's on YouTube, I think. But she looks very uncomfortable when he's talking about how they met and everything. She looks she's sort of sitting very stiff and straight and making no expression. He also made a couple of notable Christmas movies, which were totally the precursor to Hallmark Christmas movies. And I watched the 1986 classic, The Christmas Gift, with Jane Kasmerick. Total Hallmark Christmas movie trope.
Jane Kasmerick.
She was Malcolm in the Middle. Jane Kasmerick. Married to Bradley Whitford, I believe.
I think they're divorced, sad to say.
Oh, they are.
They got divorced. Rats. I really loved them as a couple. Yeah.
Are they really? I didn't know they got divorced.
I'm pretty sure.
But she's super young. I mean, it says 1986. It might have been one of the first things she ever did. But it's the total Hallmark movie trope where, you know, he's the architect in the big city in New York, you know, recently widowed. His big bad boss is going to send him to the little Colorado town to develop, you know, a ski resort. So he takes his little daughter, and then it's the cutest little Christmas town, and Jane Kasmerick is the postmistress, and, you know, he meets all the quirky town folk. And then by the end, you know, of course, he wants to save the town. I am here for that kind of movie. So I enjoyed it thoroughly. It's on Tubi. You guys, TUBI, if you don't have that, you can find a lot of old stuff there. I'm currently watching Family from episode one all the way through on Tubi. But The Christmas Gift, add it to your Christmas movie rotation. It's really cute.
We'll put that in the show notes.
And I'll put it in the Weekly Reader this week.
I'll send it right to you, Colleen.
I'm showing Carolyn and Kristen. I mean, those are just ones that I wanted to talk about. But he has over 30 TV and film credits. So I just wanted to highlight those, though.
That's amazing.
I have a feeling his film career would have been very different if he had actually accepted a role that he was offered. Now, I cannot believe this, but I double checked it. He was offered the lead role in An Officer and a Gentleman.
Oh, God. What?
No. No. No.
You guys, I found it in a couple of places in different articles that, yes,
that does not work for me.
I'll triple check before we put it out there and I'll let you know. But
let's just go with it. It's a great, it's a great nugget.
Let's just start
I wrote it down and then I read it.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Can you imagine? I mean, Richard Gere, John Denver, I have nothing left to say. Oops,
no, because when I was watching The Christmas Gift it's 1986. So he's got the very, very hip for 1986, almost the mullet type hair where it's cut straight across the ear and then longer in the back. He's lost the little glasses, but I was still kind of giggling watching him as the romantic lead, you know? And I know we talk about that in Oh God, it worked with Terry Garr, it was just a little like he's going to come into this town and immediately like sweep this woman off her feet and all of this stuff. And that's a horrible thing for me to say that I'm you know, basing that on his appearance, but he always just has that kind of youthful, oh gosh, golly look to him, doesn't he?
And that is attractive in its own context.
For sure, I mean, but not clearly, an officer and a gentleman. Or
but
as a
not
romantic
an officer
leader.
And a gentleman here, is supposed to be.
Here is like an article, and there they are next to each other. No. I don't know if you can really see it, but
look at the
can
difference.
You see, that would not. You guys, he can't be showing suave. Us. I don't want him to be suave.
One picture, you guys, is Carolyn showing us is Richard Gere in the navy whites or the naval whites with the hat and the broad
and the
shoulders. Mm-hmm. And oh, God, you guys, seriously, what did that do to all of us as young,
I know,
impressionable mm-hmm. girls?
And then John Denver,
then
John in, his Denver down, in his puffy vest.
Him, yes, he, his puffy vest, his flannel shirt, and the wire glasses.
Yes. Which is sexy. That is sexy, but it's a different kind of sexy.
It's the
Annie song sexy. Like, we want you to be Rocky Mountain sexy, not like tuxedo sexy. That's something different. Don't try to be something you're not.
I know. Can you imagine him carrying Deborah Winger? I just can't imagine him carrying Deborah Winger. He seems like he could. That she's taller than him, maybe. I don't know.
He could. He could carry Deborah Winger down the mountain in his puffy vest.
Oh, there you go.
See? That works.
Could throw
but
over
not
the back of
out
a horse.
Of the factory in his dress whites.
Oh, my gosh.
That's not right.
The Colorado Rocky Mountain High. I've seen it rain and fire in the sky.
So I don't think it's any surprise to anyone that John Denver was an activist on a massive scale. Most of his songs are about the natural world, the wonder that he feels when he's in the Rocky Mountains or observing the sky or on the ocean. We talked about the song Calypso, which is literally an ode to Jacques Cousteau's exploratory vessel named Calypso. And he wrote that song on the Calypso, on board the ship, to celebrate and support the work of Jacques Cousteau, who was the first person to do research on pollution and its effect on the sea. So in the song, it says, to live on the land, we must learn from the sea, joyful and loving and letting it be. I, Calypso, I sing to the spirit, the men who have served you so long and so well. He's applauding the environmental work of these pioneers. And even if the song wasn't about nature, nature was still a major player. Always. You fill up my senses like a night in the forest. Right? He had something to say about how the natural world was something to be saved. You know what I forgot to tell you guys? I was going to send this to you. Shoot, maybe I can still send it. So when I was up north this week, this will probably get cut out, but I'm going to send this to you anyway. I was at Split Rock State Park, and I come across, I'm just walking along the beach, and I see a little opening in the forest, and there's a little glen in there. And I was just like, oh my God, it's like a little hobbit hole. Look at it. And I go in there and I sit down on a bench. I'm sending this to you. Not a bench. I sit down on a log. And I had my phone with me, and I started playing Annie's song. I literally played it in the middle of the forest. Okay, it's coming right now. And then I'll send you a picture of my log. Here's my log. And I was like, if somebody comes along right now and is like, why are you playing music in this beautiful state forest? Isn't that beautiful?
So beautiful.
And of course, I cried. I mean, how do you not cry? It was a night in the forest.
Right. See, that's it was God dippity.
Yes, it was. He was in his heart an environmentalist, just begging people to look up at the mountains and see what he was seeing in hopes that they would care to preserve it in the same way that he does. And in this way, his protest, as it were, was wrapped in celebration instead of anger. And this was on purpose. He insisted that the word protest meant speaking up for something, not speaking against something. He never wanted to pollute his lyrics with politics because he thought music was more effective. It tapped into people's deepest feelings and it bridged the gap better than traditional political communication. Unlike, say, like Marvin Gaye's Mercy, Mercy Me, which is basically a list of climate crimes, like where did all the blue skies go? Poison is the wind that blows. Or Big Yellow Taxi, pave paradise, put up a parking lot. So, and he didn't just put this positivity into his songs. In 1976, he co-founded the Windstar Foundation, a nonprofit environmental education and research center that still exists today. He also founded Plant It 2020, which also still exists today, which is devoted to planting indigenous trees. I mean, it's just amazing the things that he did. He even testified at the congressional hearings with Tipper Gore in 1985 when they were trying to get parental advisory labels on music. Do you remember this?
Oh, yeah.
The PMRC. I don't even remember what PMRC stands for. John Denver was one of the most impactful people testifying because Rocky Mountain High had been broadly banned on radio stations across the nation because they said it had drug references in it. And he was like, you idiots, you're missing the point. Are you really going to bury the purest of messages because of your misinterpretation of the word high?
Mm-hmm. Right.
And he was like, get your heads out of your asses. He, along with Dee Snider of Twisted Sister, were the two most celebrated people testifying on Capitol Hill that day.
That's a pair.
Seriously, and they were probably fast friends after that. They were like, long live. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's good enough that you should look it up on YouTube. You'll find it. And it's the way he talks about, he tells the story, actually, Michelle, of why he wrote Rocky Mountain High and what the word high means to him and what it means. But he was more than an environmentalist. He said, I am a global citizen. I want to work toward a world in balance, a world that creates a better quality of life for all people, which led him to champion a multitude of causes, including homelessness, the HIV/AIDS crisis, and most notably, world hunger. He did as much for world hunger as he did for the environment. He was asked to serve on the Presidential Commission on World and Domestic Hunger, I think by Jimmy Carter. He co-founded the Hunger Project, his own nonprofit. He toured African countries devastated by drought and famine, and he performed benefit concerts to raise awareness and funds to fight hunger around the world, all of which resulted in his being awarded the Presidential World Without Hunger Award. This is big stuff, which makes it very strange that he was not a part of one very historic moment in the history of fighting hunger. Mm-hmm. He was rejected, rejected from contributing to We Are the World. Yes. The song, of course, it was a benefit anthem for fighting hunger in Africa. Everyone was on this song, you guys. All of the people. Can somebody please tell me why Dan Aykroyd was in the room? But John Denver was not. And John Denver had done more to fight hunger than all of those people combined. He was really the only person. Okay, I don't know jack shit, but I'm going to say he was the only person to do anything for world hunger besides that song. All of those people, again, I don't know jack shit, showed up that day and were like, look what I did for world hunger.
Right.
But they just showed up that day. Not that they didn't care. They cared. And he was rejected. And it wasn't just that he wasn't invited. He was rejected.
Do we know why?
Yes, we do. The producer has said that there were many people who were rejected, but John Denver was the most difficult one to turn down because of his involvement in fighting world hunger. But he wasn't a current artist. He hadn't had a hit in a year, in years and years. But I'm sorry, Bob Dylan he wasn't on the charts, and he's
right.
Like, no food in Africa, children are hungry.
I know, I hated that part of the song, yeah.
I know. Why does Bob Dylan get to be there and John Denver is not? And in John Denver's biography, he actually said how heartbroken he was to not be allowed to participate in that.
That hurts my heart.
Isn't that horrible?
Terrible.
And everyone would have known who he was, you know, when they were like,
yes,
when they
pan course.
The group and do the close-ups and all that. Yeah. Because I don't even know if when I watch it now, I can't tell you that I know every single person in the group that's singing. I might be like, oh, they look vaguely familiar, but I wouldn't be able to tell you their name. So in terms of lasting legacy, I'm sorry. Poor John.
I'm sorry, John Denver.
Yeah. Well, not only did John have impact in those areas that you just talked about, Kristen, I don't know if you guys knew, he was very interested in the space project. And he worked with NASA and did some things with NASA and was part of the Citizens in Space program. He was being trained to perhaps be one of the first non-astronauts to go aboard a space shuttle flight.
Oh, wow.
Oh.
He
was not obviously the first citizen to go up. It was narrowed down. I'm not sure how many, like three. It was down to three people. And of course, we know that Krista McAuliffe, the school teacher, one who actually took that spot.
And on the space shuttle Challenger.
Yes. Is that what it's on the space shuttle Challenger, which of course we've talked about before, exploded right after takeoff. And there was a chance that John Denver could have been on that flight. But he did, in turn, write a song dedicated to that flight and to Krista McAuliffe. But yeah, to be somebody, and just another interest that he had, and to take the time to get educated and perhaps be one of the people that could have gone up, like an astronaut. Pretty cool.
Yeah.
Above and below. Think about that. So his eyes were turned above to the sky and below to the oceans and to the ground beneath his feet and the mountains in front of our eyes and the trees overhead. Isn't that amazing?
That's beautiful. That is amazing. That should be the lyrics to a new song.
Coming this summer from Kristen Nelson.
We can write a tribute song to John Denver. Because sadly...
We'll sing it.
Yeah.
Hot stuff, baby, this evening. I got the hot stuff tonight.
So classic. But it makes, doesn't it make it all the more sad that we lost him so young?
Oh, it just makes it so much more of a
all
loss.
Of the impact that he was making on the world.
And that he still had yet to do. Not just musically, but through the good that he was doing.
That he was so invested in. Yeah. I remember... On October 12th, 1997, when I turned on the Today Show, as I did every day before work, and they announced that John Denver had been killed when the plane he was piloting crashed into the ocean off the coast of Monterey, California, and he was only 53 years old. And I remember feeling like a hand was reaching into my childhood and taking something away. It was one of my very first losses of a Gen X hero. I wasn't even 30 years old yet. I was just getting old enough to start accessing my own nostalgia. Because, you know, you grow up and you start to look back on the things from your childhood with a more sophisticated lens, a more sophisticated eye. And, you know, so I could have seen John Denver as something from the past, something that was kind of nerdy and goofy. And I was far more sophisticated than that. But I was growing up now and I was getting distance from that. And I was crossing the threshold into really embracing and recognizing the things that were so important to me when I was a kid. That was the power that he had over me. And I remember going to work and just, I needed to find someone to be sad with me. I was just like walking around, I'm working in this library and I'm like, hello, hello. And all the cynicism was gone. Everyone came out of the closet that day to acknowledge how important his music was to them. And there was very quickly an essay, an op-ed that came out in the Chicago Daily Herald. And you guys, I looked for this. I dug and I could not find it. I seriously thought, I'm going to call the Chicago Daily Herald. Very quickly, there was an op-ed by a woman who acknowledged everything that we were feeling. Like, yes, the haircut was funny and the glasses were funny, but this came from a different era in which we thought of things differently. And when you walk down the aisle, and some guy you paid $50 is singing "You Fill Up My Senses" like a night in the forest. That is forever. That's forever. And he gave that to us. And so I like printed it off and I'm running around the library showing this to people because it was really an awakening for me. That was one of my first nostalgic moments.
Yeah, I don't remember. I don't have a memory of where I was when I heard, but I do remember feeling just the weight of just the tragedy of it, just because of the way it happened, and just feeling that kind of gutted, you know, yucky tummy feeling. And then not really knowing. I think I've gone decades, you know, of course we all know, oh, you know, he was flying the type of plane he was flying, not exactly the type of plane, but you know, it wasn't like a commercial plane, that it was more like a glider type plane and he was alone. But it wasn't until just sometime this summer when, again, sitting around the bonfire, my husband and I are listening to John Denver and we start talking about him and his death and we start asking questions to each other. Wait, was it this and how? And wait, was he with someone and was he alone? So of course we know how we can find out the answers. We have something in our pockets that will help us. And we start doing research. And some of the stuff I found out, I wish I wouldn't have found out, that he was flying illegally. His flying license had been suspended at the time because of several DUIs. However, there was no drugs or alcohol found in his system. But just that I think it could have been so preventable. And with many of these types of accidents, yeah. it could have. But that there was like this hard to access gas handle in the type of plane
oh,
he was
God,
flying.
I can't take it.
And he took off. He did like 3 touch and go landings at the Monterey Airport before. And his fuel level was low. And they knew that before. And the guy came in and was showing him how you have to reach behind you. It's a faulty design, basically, is what they were admitting at the time. Like, yes, we need to fix. And the guy actually said to John Denver, who like designed the plane, we're working on putting that in a different place. But here's what you have to do. If you have to switch fuel tanks, you have to like lean back, reach behind you, whatever, right? So a lot of people have speculated because he had low fuel when he left that he was leaning back, grabbing the lever to switch the gas tanks. The plane went into a nosedive. However, some pilots don't believe that the placement of the valve would have made the plane nosedive like that because there was a lot of witnesses. It wasn't that far mm-hmm. off the coast. Regardless of how it happened or what the exact cause of it was, I don't think we'll ever know. I just think that no matter what, it was such a loss and so tragic and just one yeah. of those awful accidents that nobody's going to know and shocked us all and gutted us all.
Well, and when you – and we could go on and on and on, but when you were showing me how you were going behind and reaching for that mm-hmm. thing, think about when you're driving a car and you're trying to get something in your backseat, how many of us have not, like, accidentally jerked the wheel?
Right. That's what I was thinking.
Exactly.
Yeah. That he could have, like, kicked
overcorrected.
Something. Overcorrected. Yeah, and, like, well, some lever and then freaked out and
– right. And if we – and they do say there was no distress calls. He never – but I think it happened so quickly.
So after doing this episode, you guys, I have a new bucket list item, and I'm going to throw this to the listeners too. I think this would be good for the soul. Apparently, in Aspen, Colorado, you can visit the John Denver Sanctuary, where his lyrics are inscribed on granite rock boulders along a pure mountain stream. Come on, you guys. It would be a moment to appreciate how those songs have permeated our culture and our hearts and minds, how he created cultural touchstones, not just for our generation, but for all the generations that come after us, because these are living on. And to honor how those songs make us feel about the world, it's impossible to listen to Rocky Mountain High or even Annie's song and not look around you and feel grateful for the beauty of the natural world. That is his legacy. And my heart is full of gratitude for John Denver. Thanks for listening today, and we will see you next time.
Colorado, Rocky Mountain High. I've seen it rain and fire in the sky.
And to those of you who share our podcast with others, like everyone you know, and to those of you who click those stars and leave a review where you listen, a huge, huge thank you. That helps others know that our conversations are worth listening to, and we think they are. And if you haven't done those things yet, thank you in advance because we know you're just about to go do that, aren't you? And to our supporters on Patreon, there's honestly not even a high enough five for the amount of support you give us. You guys honestly keep this whole thing trucking, and we couldn't do this without you. Today, we're giving a special shout out to patrons Amy, Allie, Beth, Carmi, Stella, and another Amy because it was the 1960s and 70s. Everyone's name was Amy.
In the meantime, let's raise our glasses for a toast, courtesy of the cast of Three's Company, to good times.
To happy days.
To Little House on the Prairie. Cheers.
The information, opinions, and comments expressed on the Pop Culture Preservation Society podcast belong solely to Carolyn, the Crushologist, and Hello Newman, and are in no way representative of our employers or affiliates. And though we truly believe we are always right, there is always a first time. The PCPS is written, produced, and recorded in Minneapolis, Minnesota, home of the fictional WJM Studios and our beloved Mary Richards. Nanu Nanu, keep on trucking, and may the force be with you.
Love and it will keep moving on. Something always happens whenever we're together. We get a high.